The president of Mexico is here on July 2nd, 2000. On his birthday, Vicente Fox was elected president of Mexico. He became the first politician to break the pre-party 71-year-old grip on power. He was the first foreign leader to play host to President Bush. This unique relationship between the two presidents carried hope of great cooperation in trade, dealing with illegal drugs, and immigration. All of that has come to a standstill after September 11th. And the question is now, what happens next between the United States and Mexico? I'm pleased to have President Fox on this broadcast for the first time.
It's a pleasure, sir. Thank you very much for the invitation.
I hope we can do it again and again and again. Characterize for me U.S.-Mexican relations today.
Okay, neighbors, friendship, partnership, vision to the future. I would describe the relation like that, very profound. But for the moment, it's stagnant. It's not moving since September the 11th. Everything was optimism. Everything was planning. We were marching at high speed to solve many of the issues, of the bilateral issues. But unfortunately, September the 11th came. This was a shock to the United States, a shock to us, a shock to the whole world. And since, we've been very slow in advancing.
What's necessary to get it back on track? Because the war against terrorism will last for a while, according to the President and the Secretary of Defense and the Secretary of State.
Yes. Well, as you know, there are three main issues on this bilateral agenda. One has to do with trading, with job creation, economy. Two has to do with security, drug trafficking, organized crime. And number three, it has to do with the formal every other subject relation. In this case, what happened in September the 11th affected twofold the situation. One, by increasing the security measures that the United States had to take because of terrorism.
And so, rather than opening up, it tightened.
Right, and as we are talking about people that is not documented while working here, Mexicans that work and contribute to the U.S. economy, some consider that that insecurity factor by not being documented could affect the necessary security that the United States is looking for. And the other one, I would say, that has to do with the reduction on the growth of the economy, because more and more Mexicans were being needed by companies, by the U.S. economy, to have the capacity to grow and compete with the rest of the world. So these two aspects affected the relationship. But now we have to come back to the agenda, and we have to build on the three subjects.
Is the president receptive?
He is.
Or
he always is receptive. We have been building up all the ideas and all the plans and proposals. But yet, at the end of when we must conclude and we must commit is where we haven't reached that point. It's clear that we must work on undocumented workers. Mexican workers here are dear paisanos because they work with dignity, they work with productivity, they contribute with efficiency to the growth of the U.S. economy. But at the same time, they are not recognized legally doing that work. So we need that recognition.
That is your highest priority with the relationship?
That would be the, to me, yes, and to Mexico, it is the highest priority. And number two, we need to talk about the future so that we can orderly conduct that flow of workers that could keep on coming, but on an orderly matter. So we're working on that guest program. That would be the main elements. On the other side, we have to make sure that human rights are protected, that labor rights are protected to them. This is why we don't really accept this decision that was made by the Supreme Court here, whereby one Mexican that claimed his rights because of being undocumented, he was denied of his rights. So there we have to work to make sure that that is not going to affect the whole relationship, and that these people that, again, I say, they work legally, I mean, with enthusiasm. They work with productivity and dignity. They must be considered legal in this country.
And what separates your view from the president's view today?
No, we have the same view. The problem is that that we're paying attention, or United States is paying attention to other issues like terrorism, like the case of Middle East, and this bilateral issue seems to be put in second place.
Well, but does the undersecretary, I mean, does the assistant secretary for Latin America say to you and to your foreign minister and to others, we understand we have these responsibilities and these priorities, but we'll get to you. Don't think for a moment that we have forgotten how important Mexico is.
Yes, that's what
and
we
communicate
hear.
That message.
That's what we hear, but in the meantime, time is running. And time is running when we have also brought in commitments on working in Mexico for holding people with opportunities of work within Mexico, of working against organized crime, doing our job on the relationship, plus the fact that the whole of Latin America is going through difficult times on its democracies and difficult time on its economic situation. And I think it's the time to show leadership and to show commitment from United States, same from us, so that we work on pushing Latin America ahead of this problem that is facing right now.
Does it affect your popularity at home?
It does. It does, because we have put our trust in this relationship and in this conversations and negotiations with the U.S. government.
And
the same, we have gotten the answer that U.S. government trusts actual Mexican government, and we have committed that we can work together to pull along the relationship and make sure that it becomes very, very efficient in good results.
What has been the impact of NAFTA?
Well, up to now, it's very positive. NAFTA has created a lot of jobs for United States. Many people don't know this, but let me tell you that Mexico buys from United States more than what France, Germany, Italy, and Spain do together. So we are a partner. We consume U.S. products. We're business for United States. And so we expect also to work as partners and make sure that we keep on building opportunities for both of our nations.
But it has done what President Clinton thought it would do and what the Congress thought it would do?
Excuse me?
It has accomplished what the administration, the Clinton administration,
yes,
thought it would accomplish.
I think so. I think that the U.S. side should be very satisfied with NAFTA. We are. We have also benefited. Today we are the ninth largest economy worldwide. We are the largest in any Spanish-speaking country. At the same time, we are the eighth largest trade economy in the world. And this is due to NAFTA, in a way. So it's been beneficial to both of us and has made us partners. And this is why we should work with this partnership spirit for prosperity and for the future.
Drug trafficking. You had significant breakthrough in the last 3 months with the Felix group. Is that an indication that at long last there is some success and that those American officials who have suggested there's too much corruption and too many payoffs has begun to change?
Yes, and no doubt that is a sign, and there are other elements to prove so. For instance, during last year, we apprehended and took to jail 10,500 members of different cartels in Mexico. They're in jail today. And it's not only the Arellanos, there's other cartels where we have caught the big guys there, the big capos, and they are also in jail. And some of them have already been extradited and sent to the United States. And when we look at the statistics of drug production that we have destructed and controlled, it's sometimes 3 times fold what it was in the past.
It has always been said by many countries that are part of the supply of drugs that the problem with America is that the demand is too high and that we are, in the end, part of the problem.
no doubt, the consumption of drugs in the United States, and it's also growing in Mexico. But this market, the U.S. market, generates so much funds in dollars that those billions of dollars are used to corrupt our police and our government officials. So it's very difficult to sustain the battle against all this money that generates the drug consumption. So we have agreed with President Bush and with other security institutions within the United States that we must also hold, retain, and reduce the drug consumption in the United States. Otherwise, it's going to be a very difficult battle.
When you defeated the Pris after all those years of one-party rule, what do you think the Mexicans were asking for? What were they demanding of Vicente Fox?
Well, a change, no doubt. Change as a general demand. And but within change, what they expected is, number one, a accountable, transparent, honest, efficient government. Number two, that we would reduce poverty and increase opportunities for people. We still have too many poor in Mexico. Number three, that we will invest heavily on education, on building up human capital. And number four, security, because crime rates in Mexico reached a very high level up to year 2000. Now we've been decreasing it slightly, little by little, but that's a key issue in Mexico, rule of law and combat organized crime and regular crime on the streets, yes.
And corruption.
Of course, corruption within it, and corruption in government and corruption in society. And we are working very strongly on the issue of corruption, and we will dedicate all of our energy to that purpose. And we've done many things to advance. One is that there is no government purchase now where society is not participating directly in observing, supervising, and making sure that there is no corruption. We are controlling at the service places of government services to make sure that even at the lowest rank, there is no mordida or bite, as it's called in Mexico, ask for a government service. There we're checking every day, and we're doing a good job in against corruption. It's a long battle yet to go.
When you look at your own success in politics, having the way that you ended up in opposition to PRI, your service as governor, before that, most of your adult life was as an executive with Coca-Cola.
Yes, sir.
Coca-Cola wanted you to go to Atlanta or somewhere and run the Latin American operation, as I remember.
Right.
And you said, I'm not leaving Mexico.
Right. I was not interested on a global or international career.
Did you then have the ambition to be a politician?
Not that at that point in time, because I went back to family business, which is farming,
right,
still for 10 or 12 years. But being as a farmer and going back to contact, direct contact with poverty and direct contact with people made me change my mind and dedicate my efforts and my time to public service, to becoming a politician. And I decided to do so, and I joined politics back in 1988.
Some will say that a business background is good for you, because not you or anyone else, because it gives you a certain sense of budgets and economics and understanding of how to deal with an essential aspect of governance. On the other hand, there are those who say it's not necessarily very good because you have not had the political dynamic that running a country, running a state, mm-hmm, is very different, that politics demands something else.
Partly true and partly not. First of all, yes, the business background helps a lot, having capacities to plan, to do marketing, to administrate with energy and make sure that you accomplish things that you plan. It's very helpful in politics. And today, most of government's challenge has to do with economy, has to do with people's income, with jobs, with putting up together a working economy. Mm. But on the other hand, yes, it's needed the political know-how, and finally the service attitude. On the case of service attitude, serving others, being for others, I'm very strong. That's been my life, always serving others.
Understanding customers.
But
if you understand
politics,
customers,
yeah. You get to learn. Yeah. You get to learn. And I have learned to live within politics, lack of ethics, lack of moral issues are very complicated. You have to be very careful. It's an activity that should be the number one invest activity of a yeah. person, but we have to work a lot in making sure that politics become something that is clean, that is transparent, and that is service oriented.
You came to politics, I would assume, from somewhat of a conservative background, based on business experience.
Jesuit education.
A Jesuit education as well. That'll do it every time, won't it? But in getting elected, you allied yourself with reformists and liberals and people of the left, and in fact were associated with them in supporting other candidates. Mm-hmm. Did you find yourself, when you came to power, that you had reached out so much to so many, that you'd become all things to all people?
Uh-huh. No, I think I kept my philosophy very straightforward, but that election resulted in a government which party has not controlled on Congress,
right, right.
on either the deputy chamber or the Senate.
The priest still controls
so
the problem.
I had to govern accepting and inviting members from other parties, and most so accepting and integrating members of society which had not a political background. So I put it up together, a mix, so that I could respond to the challenge. And by the way, I went through finding and integrating this talent through headhunters and finding the very best of the best for each of the positions.
A business practice.
A business practice.
Yeah. Foreign policy. Other than this relationship with the United States, thinking of the economy that you have and your place, what is it, what's the foreign policy of Mexico today? Because I want to get to your relationship with Castro, obviously.
Okay. Well, we have shifted the emphasis on our foreign policy to the new agenda of issues that are global and that are worldwide today, like, for instance, human rights, like, for instance, nature, ecology, protection of natural resources, equity of access, specifically in the case of women, terror and security. So there is a new agenda worldwide. And the other shift has to do with the philosophy that our former governors from the PRI party, they would tell everybody, okay, don't get involved with me and I don't get to bother you. They would not accept, for instance, supervisors or visitors to check on electoral processes. They would not accept NGOs or government or United Nations visits related to human rights. So Mexico tried to stay on an island without bothering anybody else, but not accepting that anybody or any other country would get involved on Mexican politics. We changed completely. We opened to the world, and we let the world come to Mexico and live what we're living. But at the same time, we have, through that electoral process, the legitimacy and the moral authority to participate worldwide in promoting human rights, in promoting democracy, philosophy, and principles, and the other issues that I mentioned. So it's a big shift also. This is why we are now members of the Security Council of the United Nations. This is why we held in Mexico this United Nations Conference of Financing for Development. This is why we're holding the World Trade Organization meeting next year in Mexico. This is why we are presiding APEC, Asia countries right. in Mexico. And so we are decided to form part of those select countries that conduct the world, those who take the decisions. We don't want to just be part of those who complain. Now we have to assume responsibilities, and we want to be where decisions are made.
And want to play a bigger role in the region?
No doubt.
Okay. You pick up the phone on the eve of the Monterey conference. You call your friend,
yes,
from Cuba, Fidel Castro.
Yes.
And you say to him, don't embarrass me with President Bush. You expect him to have a conversation, and that would be the end of it, and he try to help you out. What happened, and why did he release the tapes?
Okay. I think at the very end, what was a discussion and what was his strategy had to do with the human rights violations discussion in Geneva. I mean, in Europe.
In Europe, right.
Every year discussion of about countries that respect or not respect human rights. For the first time in the case of Cuba, there was not a denunciation of behavior in relation to human rights with Cuba. For the first time, there was a proposal that was positive in inviting Cuba to accept the visit of the United Nations Human Rights Commissioner. So for the first time, Mexico changed its position of what the PRI used to do in the past. And we voted in favor of that request to Cuba. This was not liked by Cuba. But to us, in this new foreign policy, human rights occupies one of the main and first priorities. So this is really what was at stake. Because
not to speak of democratic
Castro,
values.
Right. Okay. Castro did not react, but until after this initiative was voted by Mexico. So I think that's what really was at stake in discussion.
And so when you released the tapes, what did you call him up and say, what?
No, what happened is that media took the tape and they started putting it all over. And some of the comments or others were that why President Fox did not publicize or made public that conversation. And I couldn't do it because I had a commitment that I established with Castro himself right at the beginning of the conversation. I told him and he agreed and he accepted that it would be a private conversation, so I could not go against my own word and my own commitment. This is why I didn't make it public, because I didn't have anything what to be ashamed about on that conversation.
Will you trust him again?
No, of course not. Not once that is done. And the problem is that now for many leaders or for many heads of state today, there would be that doubt if the counterpart would be making public private conversations, which don't have, as I said, nothing to be ashamed of, but still it was a private conversation.
But it embarrassed you that it was released or not?
Well, yes, of course. Of course it embarrassed me, yes. And but we just once he opened up the subject, I just expressed to Mexican people, it's the only ones that I owe them an explanation, and I did explain to them. Even I requested an apology to Mexicans that would consider that I had committed wrong by not making public that. So I asked for an apology to those Mexicans that would be in that position.
And did you get it?
I did make it public.
No, you made your apology.
The reaction was great. I have the support of Mexican people, very strong support.
But why would he do it knowing that it would risk the relationship between you and him and perhaps other leaders?
Well, to us, to him, it was, I think, a
strategic
very important
move.
Subject, because for 71 years that PRI was ruling the country, it was always would keep a very consistent,
right,
supportive situation about Cuba, even when Castro comes in. And it was kept always. So Mexico was always an ally to Cuba. And we keep being an ally. We keep the relationship with Cuba. We're totally against the embargo. We don't think that's the solution. So we want to keep this relationship. And everything seems to be flowing normal now after the incident.
What's necessary now for you to... What do you need primarily to achieve those ambitions you had? Is America and the relationship the primary thing that you need to get back on track in order for you to do what you think you can do to change Mexico?
Yeah. Well, first of all, I need time. And I need a little bit of people's patience because oppositions are demanding results just one day after I took over. A development process, a sustainable development process, building up human capital takes time. And Mexico is in that process, is really building and building year after year. And pretty soon we'll have a very convenient development level and position. Second, yes, I think that we need to further in the relationship with the United States. We need a NAFTA plus, as I have mentioned it. We need to conform an economic community between Canada, United States, and Mexico, where we can have a energy policy, where we can have education policy that is consistent all throughout our three countries, where we can have convergence on economic fundamental variables. That's something we need to keep on constructing. And the rest, we have to work now on the trade agreement we have with Europe, which is a huge potential market for us, and getting back together and working with our brothers in Latin America, specifically Mercosur, where we want to build up a trade agreement with Mercosur so that Mexico will be a bridge of a connection between these three parts of the world. Unfortunately, Argentina is in problems right now and is delaying the negotiations of this Mercosur. I hope that Argentina comes out of its problems as soon as possible, and we must all contribute to that. United States, Mexico, and Canada, we should work towards pushing Argentina to come out of these problems, as well as world institutions like the World Bank and the IMF and else.
One last quick question, Zapatista, where does that stand?
Well, as you know, we have, it was approved, a bill that we submitted to Congress last year for indigenous rights and culture protection, and it was approved. I could assure right now that it's maybe the most vanguard indigenous law anywhere in the world. So we have that, but still we don't have, let's say, a written peace agreement with the Zapatistas, but we've been very peaceful. There's no signs of conflict. We're working very intensely with indigenous communities, not only in Chiapas, but all over the country. We have 10 million indigenous in Mexico and 80 different languages. So we work a very strong government program to upgrade and to attend indigenous communities.
I hope that we'll have a chance to do this again. I know, speaking of trade and economic development, the mayor of New York is waiting to see you for a conversation about the city of New York and the Mexico. I thank you for your time. There were many things we could talk about, and I look forward to doing that. I very much appreciate you visiting us here on this program.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you to everybody that was listening and seeing us, and we'll see you next time. Yes.
Perhaps in Mexico.
Yes, sir.
We'll be right back. Stay with us. Tobey Maguire is here. You know him from his sensitive portrayals in such films as The Ice Storm, The Side of House Rules, and Wonder Boys. When Sony announced last year that Maguire would play the lead in the much-anticipated film Spider-Man, it came as a surprise. The choice has paid off. Spider-Man shattered all box office records last weekend with a $114 million opening. Analysts predict that it will break the $200 million mark this weekend, becoming the fastest film to ever do so. Here is a look at Spider-Man.
Let's go! Move it! Watch the street! Jeez!
I'm pleased to welcome Tobey Maguire back to this program. Welcome back.
Thank you.
Why is this resonating with movie audiences so much? What is it?
Well, I think it has a lot of elements that appeal to different age groups. I think, you know, there's the superhero aspect, the event film that's that's just exciting to go see that kind of thing. 40 years of history in this character, and people have been fans, different generations have been fans and grew up reading the comics. But I think the main thing that really gets people on a deeper level is that this is someone they can really relate to. It's a kid that they can really relate to. And you can imagine, and I know the director, Sam Raimi, said when he was a kid, he read the comics, and he said, that could happen to me, you know? I could be that kid. Whereas some of the other superheroes are really larger than life. And this is someone who you can almost imagine the fantasy to be real.
Tell us who Spider-Man is.
Spider-Man is Peter Parker, who's a kid from Queens. And he lost his parents when he was young, and he lives with his aunt and uncle. And he's just a kid who's kind of your underdog kid who really has great affection for this girl and has for years. And
who lives next door.
Who lives next door, the girl next door, Mary Jane. And, you know, he gets picked on by the bullies, but he's got a really good attitude. He's a good kid, and he doesn't let that stuff get him down. And then he gets bit by a genetically altered spider, gaining superpowers, and has to adjust to that, accept it, and understand it, and then figure out what he's gonna do with his powers. And that's the theme of our film. With great power comes great responsibility.
Your best friend in the film is the son of your ultimate enemy.
Yes.
Played by Willem Dafoe.
Uh-huh.
Roll tape. Here's a scene.
Oh, that's weird. I didn't know he was here.
Peter? Peter? Is that you?
Pete?
How strange. There's nobody here.
Bit of a slob, isn't he?
All brilliant men are.
Let me just talk about you a little bit. We've talked before, but your acting seems to have, when you look at, your mother raised you as a single parent, correct?
I went back and forth between my mother and father, but they were both single parents, and they both raised me.
Dropped out of school early?
Yes.
Why acting became what?
I think initially, because I moved around to so many different schools, socially it became really difficult for me to integrate into the school and the social thing with the kids. And I became really, well, in sixth grade, I remember I went to school in Palm Springs and I got like morning sickness for the first month. Every day I would get nauseous. And I realized later it's because I was so nervous about, you know, meeting new kids. And then I left there abruptly and moved to a couple different schools the following school year. And I think I just wanted to give up on forming new relationships and strengthening bonds, just to like let go of them completely. And so acting was a great thing for me to do and be kind of a loner and do, and became a place where I met a lot of friends who have sustained for many years. And it was just something I could really put my energy into other than school, because it didn't have as much of a social aspect to it.
We forget how important developing friends and how central friendship is to young people growing up.
Yeah.
You know? And if you have to constantly redo that because you're moving around, what a, how difficult that is.
Yeah, it was difficult, and I was talking about this with actually with Kate Capshaw, who's a wonderful woman who I did this short film with, and she was just, she probably doesn't even realize how important she was for me in my development as a person and as an actor. And you know, we just worked together for like 10 days, I think. But I was telling her about my life. She was asking me a lot of questions, and I think I was starting to get like down about it. And she looked at me and she said, yeah, but would you change anything at all? And I said, no. I mean, I had to think about it for a second. I said, no, I wouldn't. And it helped shift my perspective on it.
Because the way you developed was the way that was best for you in becoming what you should have been.
Yeah, and you know, regardless of my success as an actor, just as a person, I think I'm doing pretty well, and I'm like, you know, on track and maturing properly.
You're self-taught?
For the most part, yeah.
And from working?
Yeah. Yeah, I have studied in terms of acting, you say? Yeah, in terms of acting, I've studied with a couple teachers.
You got a lot out of that?
Absolutely, yeah. Great teachers.
What do you think this does for you, Spider-Man? I mean, are you already hearing the sort of, from people who advise you and consult with you, that you have now jumped to another place in terms of what you can do?
I'm interested to see what it does in actuality, because right now it's a lot of excitement and energy and people talking, and it's fun, and I'm just kind of on the ride right now, and I'm interested to see what happens, and I'm sure it's going to shift some things, and it just seems like it has to.
Yeah. What's especially attractive about your story from here is that, in a sense, you defined yourself. You refused to let people at first glance define who you were as an actor.
Mm-hmm.
They couldn't see you as an action hero.
Mm-hmm.
So you had to show them you could be that.
Right.
So that the definition came from you.
Yeah.
Saying, this is who I am. This is what I can do.
Yeah. Well, you know? I think,
and
too,
I don't have to live with your perceptions. I can change them.
Yeah. It's, you know, I think... For me, the odds were against me in the beginning to be able to work in films in general, so I had to prove to people that I deserved to have a place in that community, and so it's just, you know, the same kind of thing, going up against opposition and doing my best to prove the doubters wrong.
Right. Take a look at this one last clip. This is Mary Jane, Kirsten Dunst, who is the love interest, the girl next door, and when she tells Peter that she's fallen in love with him.
The fact is, I'm in love with somebody else.
You are?
At least I think I am. It's not the right time to talk about it.
No, go on. Would I know his name, this guy?
You'll think I'm a stupid little girl with a crush.
Trust me.
It's funny. He saved my life twice, and I've never even seen his face.
Oh, him.
You're laughing at me.
No, I understand. He is extremely cool.
But do you think it's true, all the terrible things they say about him?
No. Not Spider-Man, not a chance in the world. I know him a little bit.
Tobey Maguire in Spider-Man. It's great to have you back.
It's great to be here.
Congratulations on this.
Thank you.
What it's going to do is just beginning in terms of what you read in the press about how audiences are so enthusiastic about it and about your performance. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Gerhard Richter is considered to be one of the most influential painters working today. Now, for the first time in New York, the Museum of Modern Art has mounted an overview of the German artist's work. Michael Kimmel in the New York Times says, this is one of the finest, most beautiful, and strangely moving exhibitions of the work of a living painter in years. It is just about pitch perfect. The exhibit, Gerhard Richter, 40 Years of Painting was organized by Robert Storr. He is senior curator of painting and sculpture at the Museum of Modern Art. I am pleased to have him on this program. Take a look at this. This is the New York Times piece in which you see Gerhard Richter there. This was a piece written by the aforementioned Michael Kimmelman, the art critic for the New York Times. Welcome. How important is this exhibition? I mean, notwithstanding you have a point of view about this.
I think it's very important.
No, you know what I mean. I mean, give me some real sense of what it means to have Richter with this 40 years of painting on exhibit in New York.
I think a retrospective exhibition serves many functions, and it depends a good deal on the moment that it lands and the context in which it happens. In one way, this retrospective, like many others, summarizes the career of a great artist. In this particular instance, it's an artist who is not known to the general public as well as he should be, mm-hmm. and I think now is beginning to be. And it is not only a matter of taking stock of what he's done, remarkable paintings by themselves, but that including him now in the chronologies of post-war art means that we're going to have to move the furniture a little. According to what we thought was the sort of layout of post-war art. Here's an artist, for example, who made photorealist paintings in 1962. The only other artist of that time making photorealist paintings was Richard Archwager, and neither Richter nor Archwager knew each other. So in the way we talk about photorealist painting as a phenomenon of the mid to late 60s, here suddenly we have an artist who was there much, much earlier and who did things with photo painting that nobody really had taken into full consideration. Mm.
So the context has to be, you know, this a retrospective like this can help put an artist in the context of his time.
Yeah. And not just add him to it, but make us rethink what we already think about that context. That's the principal thing, that Americans have a lot of catching up to do with regards to contemporary art made outside of this country. Yeah.
What's the hardest thing when you mount an exhibition like this, assuming you've already done the hard work of the acquisition of what you want to show?
Well, the acquisition and the hard part are interconnected. An exhibition, if you're writing a book, you would say, now, look, it's obvious that this is the masterpiece and this is the lesser work, and what we want to do is talk only about masterpieces. But exhibition is an experience of work, and part of what you're trying to show the members of the general public as well as the specialized, dedicated public is how an artist thinks, in which case you don't necessarily choose only masterpieces. You sometimes choose revealing smaller works. The other thing is that you can only show so much before people's attention flags. So you have to pace it, and you have to sort of imagine the rooms in which these pictures will be seen. I, for one, use very few labels. I much prefer people to find out by looking rather than to be told by a text or what have you. But in order for that actually to function, you have to sort of bring people in, give them a sense of the pace that they're going to need, phrase the show room by room so that the cumulative knowledge of one room teaches them how to look at the next room.
Let me take a look at some of these. First one is this slide we'll see. This is called Toilet Paper, 1965. Okay. We'll see these not necessarily, mostly in chronological. I'll take a look at this. Yeah. What am I seeing?
If you consider Andy Warhol, for example, who painted soup cans,
right.
This is an equally banal object.
Right.
But Andy Warhol's soup cans were bright and shiny, right. And looked like they were fresh off the shelf.
Right.
This is the role of toilet paper when it becomes an object of use. It's an object of commercial culture which is in a sense humanized by the actual, the use of it, the fact that it's already something of our world. The other thing is that its patheticness is counterbalanced by this beautiful, beautiful aura of light. And so, in one way, it's a kind of a vanitas painting, although it's an anti-vanity object, but it's a vanitas painting about the fragility of the body.
I'm going to go through these relatively fast to give the audience a chance to see the variety of them and have you just quickly sort of characterize. Yeah. The next one is Administrative Building, 1964.
That's the look of Germany after the war. That's the new ugly construction that was the beginning of Germany's regeneration.
Next one, Mustang Squad, 1964.
Those are Allied airplanes flying over Germany. They were the planes that eventually dropped bombs on Dresden, where Gerhard Richter came from. Mm. And in this case, you have an artist making images of warplanes who had actually experienced the war firsthand. These are in a sense not abstract images at all. They're quite personal. Mm.
Uncle Rudy, 1965.
This is even more personal. This is Richter's own uncle, but he is in a way representative of the uncles or fathers of many Germans who went cheerfully off to war. In the case of Uncle Rudy, he was killed almost immediately, but he was an eager soldier. And therefore, this is a troubling image to deal with.
Horst and his dog, 1965.
This is another related picture. This is actually Gerhard Richter's father, who went off to war, was taken prisoner, and came back a broken man. And in this particular picture, he's sort of clowning for the camera, and this is his effort to sort of re-ingratiate himself with a society that doesn't want him.
Clouds, 1982.
This is an abstract painting which has multiple layers, one of which is actually a picture of clouds, a beautiful sort of photographic painting of clouds. And then on top of it are fragments of a geometric abstraction, and on top of that are fragments of a gestural abstraction. It's a series of three different paintings that don't belong together, and yet somehow they cohere.
Next one is Gaul, 1983.
Well, that is, in a sense, the toilet paper the second time around.
Exactly.
It is a Vanitas painting, truly quoting the Baroque, but it's the same light.
But 20 years later.
20 years later. And thought when he painted it, by the way, to be a totally reactionary thing on his part, since he belonged to the avant-garde. Why should an avant-garde painter paint such a traditional subject? He must, in fact, have been doing it ironically or cynically, and Gerhard is anything but cynical or ironic.
Next is Canvel's 1982.
A similar kind of picture. It evokes old master painting, but it could just as well be candles on a restaurant table. In any case, it's terribly beautiful, and it gives you a sense of the fragility of things.
Next is Meadowland, 1985.
Yet again, a picture which seemed reactionary when it was painted, because it is a beautiful painting of a beautiful sight. But the important thing which you lose in reproduction is that there is a kind of a film between you and the object. And so unlike the landscape painting that you're invited to walk into, this is one that basically says, I am there, but you can't reach me. It's a kind of tantalizing and frustrating treatment of this painting.
Next is a cell from the series October 18, 1977.
Well, this is actually The Record Player, which is another painting from the same cycle, and it was in the cell. This is a single object, which in the context of the work is sort of an enigma. In fact, it was the place where one of the prisoners was supposed to have hidden a gun with which he was supposed to have shot himself on the night of October 18, 1977. This is the end of a very agonizing series of events in German history. But here again, it's like a Vanitas painting, but it's a record player. It's a modern object. It's not a historical one.
Betty, 1998.
This is the artist's daughter, painted at the time that Richter was painting this cycle of paintings about terrorism. But the photograph was taken at the time that those events actually took place. And Richter's interest in the Baader-Meinhof group had mostly to do with the women in it, with whom he felt a strange kind of, affinity, not with their politics, but with their emotional sense of the wrongs of the world. And in a sense, he's painting his own daughter, reflecting on the history that she inherits, and a young woman coming of age in the way that these other women had come of age and made fateful decisions.
Next is Abstract Picture, 1992.
Well, first of all, the title's significant because it doesn't say abstract painting or abstract abstraction. It's a picture, and Richter always views abstraction as having some quality of representation implicit in it. In this particular case, it was a painting which was shown with a group of gray mirrors. And in the gray mirrors, you could see yourself, and you became the image of the painting in reflection. And this painting, although you can't have an actual reflection, seems to have a kind of flickering subliminal image, if you will.
Flowers, 1992.
Shown at the same time as the painting we just saw. And this is indicative of Richter. He shows bodies of work that are of two types at once. He doesn't give you an abstract show and then a figurative show. Yeah. He makes you deal with the irreconcilable differences between two conventions of painting. So next to that rather gritty gestural painting in grays and blacks, you have this absolutely lovely, exquisite, old masterish flower painting. And again, what avant-garde painter would dare to paint flowers in this manner? Nobody.
And the next is Self-Portrait, 1996.
And this is again, an almost old master's painting, but it's not. If you consider that most of the self-portraits we have historically, the artist looks directly out at you, in part because they were looking at themselves in a mirror to paint it, and in part because they wish to establish this sort of one-to-one dialogue through the eyes and the expression. Here, Richter is not looking in the mirror. It's actually a photograph he's done it. So he's introducing a disconnect between himself and the image and between you and the image.
Some people have characterized him as a cynic.
He is absolutely not a cynic.
Yeah.
He has a very skeptical mind. He has had a very, very rough life. And he has grown up in among the most troubled times one can imagine, in one of the most troubled countries one can imagine. But he is absolutely not a cynic. He is sort of possessed by the problem of whether to believe or not believe in things. And he in a sense, has a philosophical nature, but he does not want to allow himself to be led to convictions that might be misleading, might be destructive, might be whatever.
And others say, as we continue looking at this exhibition, that this exhibition in ways is a reflection of his love of painting as a medium.
Yes, absolutely. And he's been written about often as if he were finishing painting off by showing that you could do it extremely well and not mean it. And yeah. In some way, he was the fifth columnist of the Dada avant-garde, using up all the available options of painting and then leaving them, sort of dead on the floor. Absolutely the opposite. He's one of the most extraordinary painters, if you want to talk about the use of the medium, we've had. And therefore, all of his doubts about paintings are phrased in the language itself. He gives you something, as I said, in certain cases, and then at the same time indicates that you should put the brakes on before you completely succumb to an illusion, yeah. If it's a picture, or become completely enthralled with the thrust of a gesture on the assumption that it happened spontaneously. He wants you to say, no, wait a second, are you sure?
Yeah. All right, next one is Court Chapel as a Dustin, 2000.
Well, this is actually an interesting picture. It's taken with a very, very close friend and longtime supporter, Benjamin Bucklow, a German critic. And Bucklow is of essentially a postmodernist, socially critical point of view in ways that Richter himself is not.
Right.
And their dialogue, I think, has been one of the most important dialogues between a critic and an artist that we've ever had, partly because they disagree about so much, and yet they respect each other so much. And in this particular instance, Richter has posed the two of them, or they were posed in front of these old doors, and the picture says that it's in front of a church, which is the last place you would expect to find either one of them. In fact, it was in front of the academy. Yeah. And I asked Richter about that, and he said, no, it's just as well. An academy is a church. A church is an academy. What he's really saying is that the institutional entity behind us represents the social belief structures, and we are two people standing outside of them, but in their vicinity.
When you mount this, mm-hmm. you want the audience who comes to the MoMA. It'll be on until May 21st.
That's right.
You want them to come. So you've got a month to get there. You want them to come away with what? Other than the range of an artist's work and an appreciation and perhaps a reconsideration.
I want them to come away less sure of what they know about art than when they went in, but not mistrusting the artist.
Does that happen to a curator? He comes in less sure about art than he went in.
It happens to me all the time. And in a sense, one of the motives for doing exhibitions and working with an artist is to work through the problems you have with somebody who has gotten your attention, but who has not, in a sense, settled in your mind.
Great to see you.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Gerhard Richter is at the Museum of Modern Art until May 21st. Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
No, that was great. You couldn't be better.
'Charlie Rose' is made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order 'Charlie Rose' program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
On the next Charlie Rose, begin a series of conversations with museum directors and curators. We start with Maxwell Anderson of the Whitney and Lawrence Rinder, the curator of the Biennial. Welcome to the broadcast. Tonight, the president of Mexico, Vicente Fox.
So Mexico tried to stay on an island without bothering anybody else, but not accepting that anybody or any other country would get involved on Mexican politics. We changed completely. We opened to the world, and we let the world come to Mexico and live what we're living. But at the same time, we have, through that electoral process, the legitimacy and the moral authority to participate worldwide in promoting human rights, in promoting democracy, philosophy, and principles, and the other issues that I mentioned. So it's a big shift also.
And Tobey Maguire, the star of the record-breaking movie, Spider-Man.